Good morning and happy new year. It's great to see all of you this morning. Welcome to those that are here in the worship center. We want to include you in the balcony as well. Sometimes we forget you're up there, you know that, up in the balcony there. And those of you watching online, happy new year and welcome this morning. Our new ABF class for newlyweds and engaged couples begins next Sunday. If you would like to attend that, there's information online. I would ask that you do sign up online as well. Many of you have noticed over the past several weeks, we've had the screen back here in the back to take family photos out in the lobby. There's another basic purpose behind that. It's nice for you to have your own family photo, but we also would like those photos to be downloaded or uploaded, whichever word that is. Uploaded. We would like those to be uploaded to our church directory so we can match your picture with the information that we have there. We need those by January the 8th. The District Youth Winter Retreat at Camp Manawagon, January 27 through 29, cost is $55. You can sign up online, and you need to pay by January the 20th. Also, catch this, there is no youth group this Wednesday, January 4th. Wednesday Night Kids Club will resume January the 18th. Wednesday Night Kids Club will resume Wednesday, January 18th. We will have Family Fun Night with games in the Fellowship Hall starting at 7 o'clock. And there are a few remaining Christmas cards as well as offering envelopes in the lobby. Be sure to check that before you go. One final announcement before the praise team leads us in singing this morning. Next Sunday, we will begin a series in the book of Colossians. We will be going verse by verse through the book of Colossians over the next several weeks. So I would encourage you to read through the book of Colossians several times. Go ahead and start that over the next several weeks, and we'll be working through that. So just wanted to give you a heads up that you can begin prepping for our sermon series from Colossians. Stand and join us, if you would, as Ryan leads us this morning.
We have 23 hours and 55 minutes. Until the service begins. Now, are we good, Garrett? Let's give a hand to our tech team for figuring out whatever just happened. We can go ahead and pull up that first song. Let's make sure the computer doesn't crash. There we go. Hey, I get a lot of good input, let's put it that way, that why do we stop Christmas songs just because Christmas is over? So we're going to do a Christmas song every week of the year this year. I'm just kidding. That was a terrible joke. No, but it's still that season leading toward Epiphany. Not that we really follow that calendar as a church, but it's still technically the Christmas season. There's still a tree there, so how about we do a Christmas song one last week? Let's sing together.
Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him in Christ the Lord.
Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Oh, sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, oh, glory in the highest.
Oh, come, let us adore. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory give. Word of the Father, now in flesh appear. Let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. We'll give him all the glory. We'll give him all the
His name forever. We'll praise his name forever. We'll praise his name forever. Christ the Lord.
Amen. Well, let's meet and greet each other. If you see somebody you don't recognize, make sure you introduce yourself, and Happy New Year.
The PJs look great this morning. This is what I usually sleep in. I'm just ready to go all the time. So, as the ushers come forward for our offering this morning, I did want to make a special announcement about our marriage retreat coming up. The marriage retreat is February 17th through 19th. It's at Roxbury Camp, and there's brochures out in the lobby there if you want to take a look at a brochure. They're also available online or through the church app. And I know one of your resolutions this year was to sign up for things way before the deadline, and you have the opportunity to meet that resolution. Next week, the early bird discount is ending. And so make sure that you sign up by next week to get that early bird discount for the camp. But I'm really excited for this year. I've been in contact since last summer with a pastor, author, whose name is Andy Farmer. He's going to be coming with his wife, Jill. He's the author of a book called Real Peace, which is a wonderful book, as well as other titles. But he also serves on the council board of Biblical Counseling Coalition, but he's come up with this theme of building a resilient marriage, and I'm excited for what he has to share with us through that time. And so I'd really encourage you to sign up for that. If you know someone that you can encourage to sign up for that, we'd love to have you be a part of that. We're going to see that in the video in just a moment. So if our ushers come forward, I'll pray for this morning's offering, and then we'll watch that video. Father, we thank you so much for your faithfulness. Thank you that we can look back at this past year and see your goodness, your grace, your mercies that were new every morning, and see your faithfulness woven through each and every day. And we thank you that days like today are a reminder that our times are in your hand, and that you are over and above all things, and you're working all things according to your plan, to your glory. We pray that 2022 lifted up great glory to you, and we pray that for 2023, that this year would be a year that your name is made known in our hearts, in our lives, in our homes, in our community, and in our world. And I pray for your work within our church, within our families, and that we would come to know you in greater ways. But we thank you for the truth that you have for us. Thank you for this opportunity that we have to give to you, to give towards your work and your mission in this world. And so I just pray that you would be glorified through this. Pray for our continued praise and worship to you, that it would bring honor to your name. Pray for Pastor Darrell as he brings forth your word this morning. And I ask all of this in Jesus' name, amen.
It's a silent movie. We'll start it again whenever it works. I'll stall while they do this. I was running late this morning, walked out to my driveway, and my tire was flat. So I had to call my mommy to come pick me up for work. Last week when I tried to start my van, it wouldn't start because it was 0 degrees. So I had to call my mommy to pick me up for work. That's 2 weeks in a row. Got here, something I still don't even know if
I figured out.
There we go. All right, Andy's ready. I'm going to finish my story. Got here, I don't know what was going on with Cooper's guitar or something. Oh, the cable went bad. It took us an hour to figure that out. The computer crashed. God is good, right? We don't need all that stuff to go completely right to have a good worship service this morning. So I think, are we ready, guys? Thumbs up. All right, here's the video.
Hi, friends. Andy Farmer here. My wife Jill and I are looking forward to coming and being with you in February. For the marriage retreat. We're very excited to spend time together, to talk about marriage. Our marriage of 38 years is one that's full of joy, but also has had its challenges, as all marriages do. And that's what we're going to be focusing on in this retreat. We're going to be talking about resilience in marriage. How do we keep our marriages resilient? Resilience has two factors involved. One is that resilience means that something is not brittle. It's not easily broken or cracked under stress. A resilient product is also something that retains its shape. Though it's buffeted in various ways, it retains the shape in which it's intended to be. And that's what we want for our marriages. We want our marriages to be able to retain the shape God intends, no matter what we go through in life. And we want our marriages to be resilient, that they don't break or crack under stress. I know that's your heart. That's our heart as well. That's what we've seen God do in our own lives. And so we're just excited to come and talk and fellowship around this when we're together. So look forward to seeing you. Please come out and join us. And Happy New Year.
Let's stand together and sing. How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the world. one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. And there will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer we prayed in desperation, songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, and in the end we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died. Day we join the resurrection, stand beside the heroes of the faith, and with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. A mighty Lord, glory to our God who gave us life beyond the grave. Holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is the
Dear God, that you are holy, and we get to sing that to you as a church family, I pray as we begin this new year with you that whatever baggage we had in the past, we can leave that in the past, and we can start fresh with you today. We give this prayer in your son's name. Amen. You may have a seat. And children are dismissed. And I know it's PJ Day, so I'm expecting someone to bring me back a Pop-Tart, PJ Pop-Tarts, expecting at least one Pop-Tart today. These are some really creative pajamas. All right, so today is the first day of 2023, so happy New Year to everyone. And maybe you have some New Year goals this year. Maybe for some of you, it's, you know, get in better shape. Maybe for some of you, it's a career change. Maybe it's financial moves. And maybe some of you today, a good goal for 2023 is you want to support the pastor who's on stage right now with an all-paid expense trip to Star Wars Land, right? Maybe, I don't know, that's a goal you might not have, no idea. But hopefully a goal for all of us is that we want to know God better. And how do we better know God? We better know His Word. And hopefully this morning, and we're going to look at the Old Testament, we're going to look at the laws of God. And, you know, that's such a massive subject. There's no way we're going to cover everything about God's laws. But hopefully this morning, after we're done, we can look at God's laws. We can have a better appreciation for them. And we can say, how does this relate in our lives? And how do we see Jesus working in all these things? So that's my goal for this morning. So with that said, let's look at our first text. This morning. It's Leviticus chapter 19, verses 1 through 2, and we're told this. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for the Lord your God, I'm holy. Right. Yeah, for the Lord your God am holy. So what we learn from this text would be this, our very first point this morning. Let's go to the next slide. Is this, God's law reveals to us God is concerned with holiness. So when we look at God's laws, what are something we walk away with? God is concerned with holiness. And this is kind of a big theme in Scripture. I have a picture right here I want to show you. So here, the one picture with God's throne, remember this is from Isaiah chapter 6, and Isaiah, he gets a vision of heaven, and what does he see? He sees these angels, like, flying around the throne room of God, and what do they say about God? They say God is holy, 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 that they're consistently flying around God's throne, and they are saying holy, holy, holy. A next glimpse of heaven we get is in Revelation, and we see John, he sees another throne. He sees four living creatures. And what do they say? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. So whatever we get here is that holiness is big to God. That when we think of God, we think of God as powerful, we think of God as loving, but we also think of God as holy. And God says his commands for us to be holy as he is holy. So maybe that would make us think this. Our question for today would be this. What does it mean to be holy, right? So if God says he is holy and he commands us to be holy, we have to think, okay, so what does that mean to be holy in the sight of God? And I was looking, trying to like find a good definition for this, and I went through one of my textbooks. It's called Basic Theology by Charles C. Ryrie, and it's a really good book if you're interested in stuff like that. And this here's a definition for holiness that can work for us this morning. It's this. Holiness in the Bible means separation from all that is common or unclean. In respect to God, holiness means not only that he is separate from all that is unclean and evil, but also that he is positively pure and distinct from all others. So, in other words, holiness means different, right? That God is different from anything in all creation. He is above everything in all creation. That God's moral character, that God is pure and God is good and God is light. So for us as God's people, right, what does that mean for holiness in us? What does it mean to be pure, right? What does it mean to be separate and distinct, to be different from the rest of the world? How many of you enjoy movies? Show of hands. Any movie buffs out there? So me and my dad, the way my dad would connect with me, he would show me a lot of movies. That maybe that's why I love movies today, because that's something that happened in my childhood. Me and my dad, you know, maybe talking wasn't always our strongest suit, but hey, we would watch movies, and he would show me movies that have like life lessons, and he showed me this one movie. It's called Billy Jack, and let me show you the picture here. This is Billy Jack, and Billy Jack is a weird movie. Incredibly weird. It's about a Native American cowboy kung fu master that fights racists. And like I said, it was a really weird movie. I'm not sure what the life lesson Dad wanted me to get from it, but I remember there's this one scene that Billy Jack, there's these Native Americans are being messed with. Billy Jack, he kills the guy who's like messing with the Native Americans, and like the cops show up, they want to arrest Billy Jack, and Billy Jack's girlfriend is like, hey, let's run away. let's leave here. Let's start somewhere new. Let's go. Let's start somewhere different. And Billy Jack, he looks at her and he says, okay, I will go with you. Show me the one place in this world where there's no injustice. Show me the one place in this world where people are actually treated the way that they should be. Show me one place in this world where goodness actually exists. And I will go there with you right now. She couldn't think of one place. When we think of the Bible, when we think of God's commands, right, that the world's a messed up place. And a lot of us, we talk about a nation under God. What we're going to do for the rest of this morning, we're actually going to look at a nation that was directly under God. We're going to look at what was God's heart for this nation that was under him. How was this one nation supposed to be different from all the other nations on the planet? And what was God's goal for humanity? So let's look at our next text. We have God, he's talking to Moses, and he's telling them to speak to Israel. Remember, Israel, they're supposed to be the one nation directly under God. That's supposed to be different from all the surrounding nations. And what does God say? He says this: the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. Every one of you shall revere his mother and father, and you shall keep my Sabbath. I am the Lord your God. Do not turn to idols or make for yourselves any gods of cast metal. I am the Lord your God. Let's continue. Next text. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap your field right up to the edge, neither shall you gather the gleanings after your harvest, and you shall not strip your vineyard bare, neither shall you gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and for the sojourner. I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal. You shall not deal falsely. You shall not lie to one another. You shall not swear by my name falsely and to profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. So what do we get here from God's law? We're told this, our next point. God's law reveals to us, first, that God is concerned with holiness. Second, God is concerned with family relationships, proper worship, and people being treated correctly. That when we look at God's laws, and some of it's really confusing, and some of us, we don't always get it, like here's the heart behind it. That the heart behind this is that God is concerned, like we talk about holiness and goodness and purity and all this stuff, like what does that look like in our family relationships? This whole idea of revere mother and father is respect. Respect your mother and father. That God is concerned with what takes place within your household. And for some of us, I get this, family, that's really tough. That's incredibly hard. Look, you guys know my story, and you know how confusing family dynamics are for me. And for some of you in this room, like, family is a complete, it breaks your heart. And here's what I can tell you. As you follow Jesus, as you follow God, because sometimes we can get up here as pastors and we can act like we know your situation and we don't. Right, I don't know how to fix like your problems, like because like people don't know how to fix my problems, and I could try to give you this generic answer that's gonna make everything okay, and it won't. But I can tell you this: as you follow Jesus, as you follow God, right, as you pursue that relationship, God will give you wisdom. God will give you wisdom in how to navigate the messiness of family. I can guarantee you that, right? Because God's heart is there. And because God's heart is there, God will help you navigate through life. Right? So then we also have proper worship. So once again, we don't worship God any way that we want, but we worship God according to his standards. That a lot of people will say they're spiritual, but are they obedient? That we look at God's laws. There is a proper way to worship, and there's an improper way to worship God. That, like, think about it, atheism wasn't a big thing during that part of the world. That everyone had a God. That you didn't find an atheistic nation surrounding Israel. That everyone was trying to worship God, but they weren't worshiping the God of heaven. Proper worship matters to God. And then we see this, people being treated correctly, that he tells them, hey, when you're in your vineyard, right, you don't take every single grape. Why? Because there's people that need that. And they just didn't like hand it out to them. The poor people had to go into the vineyard and they had to gather the grapes. But God was concerned with every member of society, from the very rich, from the very poor. God is saying, hey, in my nation, a nation under me, everyone matters. Every single person matters. And this is God's heart, that we look at holiness, being distinct, being different, being purely good. It comes back to our worship. It comes back to our family dynamics. It comes back to our relationships with the other people in that nation. When we read God's law and we read the Old Testament and there's things that are just culturally different, yeah, don't forget God's heart. And I know we have this image of God in the New Testament as this really generous, loving father, and God in the Old Testament, like, just having major anger problems, right? It's one God. He's one God. God's heart is the same in both the Old and New Testament. And God's laws reveal his heart for his people. Which brings us to our very next thing right here. Clean versus unclean. So once again, some of this is really difficult. It's really hard to understand. And we're not going to go through every last point of Old Testament law this morning, but a big thing is clean versus unclean. And how do we properly understand that? Well, here's a text that might help us out a little bit. Here's Leviticus 11, 13 through 19, and we're told this. These are the birds you are to regard as unclean and not eat because they are unclean. The eagle, the vulture, the black vulture, the red kite, any kind of black kite, any kind of raven, the horn owl, the screech owl, the gull, any kind of hawk, the little owl, the cormorant, the great owl, the white owl, the desert owl, the osprey, the stork, any kind of heron, the hoopoe, and the bat. So I know you're thinking, hey, how's a bat a bird? Right? How'd that happen? Like, National Geographic never told me that. But God says a bird's a bat. Well, no, that's not what's happening here. The word bird here, it refers to, like, numerous flying creatures. That's why a bat can be here. And also, I was studying this week. You look at verse 16, there's going to be some translations. They're going to say ostrich instead of screech owl. And the reason why, there's just arguments about, okay, how do we properly interpret that word? So some of this, it just falls back into what camp you land in. And if you land in the camp that you read screech owl as ostrich and you do study, that's great. For me, I just landed in this camp here. Reason why? You look at different commentaries, they'll say this. You go with this list here of birds, and I guess the bat, right? These are all, like, I just look at the birds. They're all birds of prey, right? They're all birds of prey. And why does that matter? Because everything on here, how do they live? They live by killing something. Like, in order for these creatures to live, something has to die. So for this clean versus unclean animals, and granted, there's no unanimous list why certain things were unclean, but here is something to keep in mind. Actually, I did forget one thing. How many of you guys know what a hoopoe is? Show of hands. Okay, Chris Dunn, you know what a hoopoe is? How many of you have no idea what a hoopoe is? Like, this boy, like, I was reading this text, like, what's a hoopoe? I had no idea. So here's a picture of a hoopoe. It's like this crazy hairdo and everything. It's like a mohawk. It's probably listening to punk music or rock music, I don't know. But it's a hoopoe. And to be fair, you know, this is a hoopoe, like, first time for some of you ever seeing a hoopoe. And this isn't really fair to the hoopoe. So here's a better picture of a hoopoe once it got his hair done and, you know, put his makeup on and everything. So here's a much more attractive picture of a hoopoe. So if you learned nothing else this morning, you know what a hoopoe is. And if that's the thing you get from this morning, that I have done a horrible job. Right? Okay? So, but once again, why this list of clean versus unclean? And here's just one reason. Once again, there's no unanimous agreement why, but here's at least one reason. Let's go to the next slide. Okay. Wow.
Clear button.
Hit the clear button. I don't know. Thank you. Actually, that's a pretty hard job. Can you give them a hand up there? That is not easy. That is not easy, right? But here's, I've been reading this book, From Paradise to the Promised Land, and I'll show you a quote I got from it. A common factor among many of the unclean animals is that they depend on the death of other creatures in order to survive. In Leviticus, death and uncleanness are generally linked, being the opposite of life and holiness. By eating clean animals, the Israelites distanced themselves from death, which was perceived as the source of uncleanness. So the whole point I want to get from this would be this. Next slide. God's laws reveals to us that God is concerned with life and death. This whole thing of clean versus unclean, that God wanted a nation under him to avoid death. To avoid death and to cling to life. And how do you cling to life? God said, hey, it's by obedience, it's by following me. Right? That here is death right here. And you read a lot of these Old Testament laws, like about leprosy or skin disease or these other things. God wanted his people to know that there is death and there is life. And he wanted that distinction in their mind, that outside of him, like all these surrounding nations around you, that is death out there. How do you find life? It's by obeying me, and that's how you have life. So God's laws, right? God, it reveals God's heart, that God is concerned with life and death, and he wants his people to have life. So we see right here, God is concerned with holiness. God is concerned with proper relationships, with proper worship. God is concerned with life and death. How did Israel do with all this? So let's go to our next slide. So you'll see here the green and like the orange, right? That's the kingdom of Israel right here. And I want you to look, there's all these surrounding nations around them. And the visual aid here you're supposed to get is this, that Israel is right in the middle of all these nations, that Israel was meant to be a light, that Israel was meant to be an example, that Israel was meant to show the rest of the world how life was supposed to take place. They failed miserably. They failed miserably. That all these nations that are surrounding Israel, that are supposed to look at a nation under God, and they're supposed to see something different and distinct, they didn't see that at all. that the story of the Old Testament becomes incredibly sad because what ends up happening, Israel, they become just like these other nations, or in a sense, they become worse. That all the problems you find in these surrounding nations, you end up finding in Israel. That when Israel was meant to be a light and an example, they were just like everyone else. So when it comes to this, like what hope do we find? Right? That when Israel failed, Jesus succeeded. Because here's what ends up happening with a sermon like this. I can make this mistake. Hey, you gotta try harder. Hey, you gotta do better in your family. Hey, you gotta do better in your worship. How often are you reading God's word? And I could throw all this effort on you, and I could say, hey, this falls all on your shoulders, right? Don't be Israel. And I would fail because guess what? We all are sinners. That who do we look to? We look to Jesus. Because as we go into God's word and we think this is eternal life, what does Jesus say about all this? Let's go to our next text. It's John chapter 5, 39 through 40. And you have Jesus, and he's talking with these Jewish leaders, and they're harassing him, and they're having this argument. Jesus says this: "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me. Yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life." That as we search the scriptures, what are the scriptures chiefly about? Like what's the Bible chiefly about? It's about Jesus. It's about Christ. That as we look at the word scriptures here, it refers to the Old Testament. That the Old Testament is about Jesus. So when you read God's laws, it's not so much about you and your own effort trying to will yourself to do this, but it's you realizing, hey, I can't do this. That if this is all on me, I am in serious trouble. That what do? We look to someone far greater than us, that Jesus kept the law perfectly. That we read some of the New Testament, like you read some New Testament books, they'll say this, that Jesus is the true Israel. Why? Because Israel was meant to be a representation of God on earth, and they failed miserably. Jesus, fully God, fully man, right? He shows us exactly what life is supposed to be like. That I'll bring this point right here. Let's look at our next slide. Here's our fourth point. God's law reveals to us that Jesus is the only one that kept the law perfectly. Jesus is the only one that kept the law perfectly. And I talked about family relationships earlier. Look, no one knows what it's like trying to navigate messy family more than Jesus. That if you read the Gospels and you read that family dynamic, it is messed up. And that gives me hope. And that should give you hope too, that as you follow Jesus, as you work on your relationship with Jesus, as you're loving Jesus, there is wisdom there in how to navigate the messiness of life. That when we look at Jesus, like how did he look at the Old Testament law? And there's over 600 Old Testament laws. I believe 613 to be exact, but how did Jesus navigate through all those laws? This is the way he interpreted them. This is the way he looked at them. Let's go to our next slide. This is Matthew 22, verses 34 through 40. "But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together," and you know, Pharisees, Sadducees, think Jewish religious leaders, right? And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" And he said to them, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. That Jesus looked at God's law and he poured it down, he boiled it down to, hey, I have to love God, I have to love my Father, and then I have to love my neighbor as myself. And that's how Jesus navigated his life. And that's how Jesus kept the law perfectly. And only Jesus could fully love God. And only Jesus could fully love his neighbor. And which brings us to this whole point right here. Our hope is not found in a nation under God, but in the Savior of a nation. And not just a Savior of a nation, but the Savior of the world. My friends, some of you, your great hope is in 2024 and to vote for a president. You're missing the scriptures, right? We did that experiment, right? Israel, directly a nation under God, it didn't go well. What is our hope as believers? And let me say this. I'm not saying politics don't matter. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying if your chief hope is whoever is in the White House, you're missing the heart of the scriptures. Our chief hope is not a nation under God, but the one that can save the nations. That's Christ. That's our chief hope as believers. And to try to wrap this all up, like what does this all mean for us, like practically? Let's go to our next text right here. This is Acts chapter 10, verses 25 through 29. And you have Peter. He has this vision, and in this vision, he sees all these animals that were unclean. And God tells him, hey, go kill and eat all these unclean animals. And for some of you, that'd be a cool vision for you. You could be a hunter and kill like animals or whatever. But right, Peter's like, I don't know about this. These are unclean. And he showed him the vision, I believe, three times. And, you know, the vision goes away. And these guys, they come to Peter to go to this guy's house named Cornelius. And we pick up the story here. When Peter entered, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter lifted him up, saying, stand up. I, too, am a man. And as he talked with them, he went in and found many persons gathered, and he said to them, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone of another nation, but God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without objection. I asked them why you have sent for me. Because Peter, right, being a devout Jew, clean versus unclean, he saw people as clean and unclean. And yet God is telling him, hey, Peter, don't look at any person as clean or unclean. Why? Because of the new covenant. Why? Because of Jesus. And here's a quote I want to show you to wrap this all up. It would be this. And we're told here, once again, from Paradise to the Promised Land. Previously, God introduced the concept of clean and unclean foods to separate the Israelites from the other nations. Now, in the New Testament period, the distinction between clean and unclean food is abandoned in order to show that God no longer distinguishes between clean Jews and unclean Gentiles. With the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ, the Gentiles are now recipients of God's grace and mercy. In light of this, it is only natural that the divinely instituted regulations concerning clean and unclean foods should be abandoned. They no longer serve any meaningful purpose. And the whole idea behind this is this, that we look at the Old Testament law. Some of the Old Testament law doesn't apply to us today as New Testament believers. A good rule of thumb to know what Old Testament law that we are directly under, it would be this. Does the New Testament, like in the letters to the churches, do they clearly state those laws for us? If it's not clearly stated, a good way to interpret that is that Old Testament law was meant for that period in time. That clean versus unclean, that was meant for a period of time. And here's the joy for us. It means this, that God told Peter, look, there's people that need the gospel, and you need to go to them, and you need to interact with them. In 2023, what people will God place in your life so that you can share the gospel with them well? Whether that's unbelievers that have never received salvation, that God could use you to help them be saved, or is it another believer in this room that you could have a meaningful discipleship relationship with and have them grow in their faith? 2023, this could be a great year for you spiritually as you walk in obedience with Christ and as we pursue holiness together as a church family. I'm going to pray and ask the band to come back up. Dear God, thank you for this morning, and thank you for your word. Thank you that your laws reveal your heart, that you are holy, and you've called us to be holy. And how do we find holiness? It's in our relationship with you. That as we trust your son, and as we spend time with him, as we just grow in our relationship with your son, you will help us navigate life. You want your children to know how to honor you. Help us navigate life. Help us love you more this year than we did last year. Help us grow together as individuals and as a church family. We give this prayer in your son's name. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing. Let's let this closing song be a prayer from our heart, not just words that come out of our mouths, but a prayer to God as we sing it. Sing together.
This world is empty, pale, and
To the nations. So here's a follow-up question, something to think about and discuss this week. In what ways do Christians today need to strive to be a light? Be specific about your situation. In what dark situations can I shine the light of Jesus, even this week? So take some time to discuss that and pray about that. Pastor Daryl has a few more follow-up questions on the website, so make sure to check that out. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you, to get in your word. We thank you for a new year where we can continue to serve you. I pray that we can really reflect on that. What dark situations can I shine into this week for you? What situations can you use me to shine your light? Help us to really take that seriously as a serious challenge this week. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks for joining us. You're dismissed.